Verehrte Gäste, jetzt geht es wieder rund. Es geht um das Spektakel bei der US-Wahl. Darum dreht sich jetzt die folgende Session. Joe Biden gewann, wie wir alle wissen, letzten November mit 7 Millionen Stimmen Vorsprung vor dem damaligen Amtsinhaber Donald Trump. Dennoch glauben bis heute ein paar Dutzend Millionen von Amerikanerinnen und Amerikanern, Trump sei um die zweite Amtszeit betrogen worden. Denn der Ex-Präsident befeuert den Glauben an eine rigged election. Die Folge: die Erstürmung des Kapitols am 6. Januar durch fanatische Trump-Anhänger und 5 Tote. Trump ist vorbei, aber das Vertrauen in die Demokratie ist erschüttert. Darüber diskutieren jetzt Rieke Havertz aus Washington, Juliane Schäuble aus den USA, David Fahrenhold, Annette Meiritz und Dr. Christoph Freiherr von Marschall zu Bieberstein. Herzlich willkommen.
Thank you for the introduction and welcome also from myself here from Berlin. It's been a long conference day, at least here in Germany. In Washington, of course, it's just lunchtime. We are happy for everyone who is with us for our panel. Another normal prospect for US democracy, politics and media. And I can tell you, you have made an excellent choice to stay tuned here with us. We will give you insights from the White House and news about the new administration under President Joe Biden. How have working conditions changed for the media from Trump to Biden? How are the odds that President Biden will be successful with his ambitious agenda of reform, change and reconciliation? And last but not least, what will change in transatlantic relations? Hopefully for the better, of course. My name is Christoph von Marschall. I'm the chief diplomatic correspondent of Der Tagesspiegel, the leading daily in the German capital, Berlin. And I have been serving myself as US correspondent under 3 presidents, George W. Bush, Barack Obama, and Donald Trump. I'm joined by 4 wonderful colleagues on the other side of the Atlantic, all based in Washington, D.C. And you heard it already in alphabetic order. Rieke Havertz reports for the weekly Die Zeit. Juliane Schäuble is my dear colleague for Der Tagesspiegel. Annette Meiritz is U.S. correspondent for the Economic Daily, Das Handelsblatt. And David Fahrenthold is a reporter with the Washington Post already for 20 years. He has covered the Trump family and Trump's business interests and was awarded a Pulitzer Prize for national reporting in 2017. We will first talk here on the panel about the 3 subjects I mentioned already: the change in domestic politics, the conditions for the media, and new opportunities for transatlantic cooperation and global affairs. And afterwards, we are happy to take questions from the audience. If you have been with us through the day, you know the drill. On the upper right-hand side of your screen, you will find Slido. That's where you write your question. Don't use the chat button for your questions. Please use Slido. And with that, let's start to talk business. Let's begin with David Fahrenhold, because he is such an insider when it comes to Trump's behavior. How are working conditions for the media right now in the US, especially in Washington, D.C. and in the White House? There are probably 2 big dynamics, from the Trump to the Biden administration on one hand side, and the impact of Corona. And I wonder what you think, which has the bigger impact? David, please.
Well, the biggest change, obviously, in the last few weeks has been from Trump to Biden. And that's a change in hostility. There's less hostility, obviously, from the Biden folks against the news media. They don't see us as the enemy of the people. They may just see us as, you know, day-to-day adversaries or people they find annoying, but they're not going to sort of direct the public's fury against us. Also, I think the Biden's folks' adherence to a schedule, we were just talking about before this started. Now, if I wake up in the morning and I see a news alert on my phone from 3 in the morning, my first thought is not that it's a U.S. political story, right? The Biden folks are going to do things during the daytime. They're going to make news when they want to make it. They're not going to make news off Twitter at 3 o'clock in the morning. That's going to make it easier in some ways logistically to cover this presidency. It's going to be much more like a presidency before Trump, and that the president will generally make news only when he wants to. That's in some ways less exciting, but it also gives us more time to examine the things the president has done instead of just being caught up in the next day's tornado. So I hope it leads to sort of more in-depth coverage of Washington, as we're not trying to just keep up with what Trump is saying he's going to do. And I don't think there'll be a news cycle about Joe Biden trying to shoot a nuclear missile at a hurricane or to buy Greenland. So we hopefully will have more time to cover the things that he's doing.
We will certainly, David, if you allow me one follow-up. You have been covering administrations for many, many years, and Congress also. So if you look back, Obama to Trump, now Trump to Biden, do you think we come back to media working conditions as we had before the Trump administration, or is there some other change still here in play?
Well, coronavirus is still changing a lot about how we do our job. You know, there's a lot of things that we just can't observe in person, or that observing in person is much riskier. I think the question now, the difference between the Obama years and Biden years, it may be defined by partisan media. There are folks who cover the news who call themselves journalists for OANN, for Newsmax, even for Fox News, that will see themselves as partisans, you know, that they don't mind being seen as sort of partisan work activists, partisan actors. And I think the way that the Biden folks deal with that in the news media is going to really be a change from Obama. That didn't really exist in the Obama era. So I think the mainstream, the nonpartisan news media will probably do our jobs. It'll be very similar to the Obama era. But the way that those hard right news outlets that were so pro-Trump during Trump's term, the way that they act, I think, will change the dynamic pretty sharply at the White House.
Rieke, Annette, and Juliane. And I will start with Rieke, but I think the question concerns you all. You are in a very different position. It is a difference whether you are a foreign reporter in Washington, D.C. or an American reporter, whatever beat you cover. It's just also a question of access and so on and so on. So Rieke, maybe you tell us first about your experience. What are your working conditions right now, and where are the big changes? When did they happen? When Corona came, or now from Trump to Biden?
I think for me, it's pretty unique because I actually only came to the United States to cover the election last summer. So I moved in the midst of the pandemic. So for me personally, the COVID situation, of course, has been the biggest challenge because it was very hard to connect with people, with colleagues, with possible interview partners. So for me, that has been the biggest challenge. Just to give you one example, to just get credentials for Congress, now there's a 6 month to 1 year wait list. So although I've been here since August, I still don't have any credentials for the Congress due to the COVID situation. So that makes it for me very much harder than, I guess, for Juliane or Annette, who've been here longer and of course have more access because they've been here longer. But of course, also I've seen the change just in, as David said, tone and speed since the Biden administration. There's their Sundays are back, as we already mentioned. So you can actually, I just mentioned, I read a book on Sunday just because I knew I can, and I was not like watching my phone constantly worrying that there would be another breaking news story. And I have the feeling that Washington is breathing a bit more, and with that comes more access. But of course, it's been very hard for foreign journalists forever to like gain access. I mean, I've been in Georgia to cover the special elections, and I met some press people there from John Ossoff. And of course, I got back to them when they were now in Washington, D.C., saying, hey, I would love to follow up. I would love to do a story, because of course, John Ossoff is of big interest for German readers, and they were very friendly, but they were like, well, sorry, but we have to pass on that, because of course for them it's not high up on their priority list.
Thank you, Rieke. Annette, you are a longer time already serving in Washington, D.C. than Rieke. Just tell us your observations.
Yeah, I was nodding all the time because everything that Rieke said I experienced as well, but maybe I can add something that is specific for me as a correspondent for a business and financial daily. I usually write with an economic angle, and something I discovered during the Trump administration was that many CEOs and business owners, either small businesses or larger businesses, were pretty afraid speaking up or like giving me quotes on the record, because they were scared that they get a tweet from the President Trump. And that was really different, because usually the American business owners are very eager to talk to Handelsblatt because they are European investors as well on the other side, and they have an interest in communicating to the European audience. And that changed a little bit during the Trump administration. I really hope that this is going to be a little bit different now, that they are not scared anymore, because the business world, as you know, they are always caught in between this political interests and their own interests. So this is a very interesting thing to see. And just one more thing to add, I had the same experience with the John Ossoff team. So we are not on top of the list, and for the moment we have to accept it.
So I just, before I ask Juliana, I just say that I can't see yet any questions from the audience. Please feel invited to ask or comment whatever you want already now. We will then, of course, follow up if you have questions right now to the subjects we cover. Juliana, of course, we are in most close contact since from all the four of you in Washington, D.C., since we work for the same newspaper and are regularly in conferences. So I know that you try, for example, to get into the White House, and there are many obstacles. Just tell us your practical experience. How is your work daily? You just live a few hundred meters north of the White House on your street, and how is access? How are the obstacles?
Not easy, I have to say, and I think it has gotten worse under Biden, because not because he doesn't want to have journalists around him. They just are more serious about Corona. Right now, we have to win a lottery for like daily access. Every day you want to go in the White House, you have to win a lottery ticket to get a test. So the good thing is I get tested quite often. The bad thing is very often when you would like to go, you wouldn't get the test. And then you also have to get the normal access, which if you don't have a hard pass, as Christoph, you had in your time, that allows you to go every time you want, you cannot even go into the briefing room anymore. So I can go down to the White House and I can stand in front of the windows and look inside when there's a press briefing, but I have no access. They're really restricted to, I think, 80 journalists on the White House compound, and in the press briefing room, is it 30? Correct me if I'm wrong, but like not really a lot. So they say, and it's right, you can watch it on TV, the Corona briefings now are virtual anyway, so we all watch even more TV than before. And then now we have the security threats after January 6th and what we have seen in DC. So it's even now complicated to get into the Capitol, which was not as complicated as to get into the White House if you have the hard pass, which Rieke, I'm sorry that you can't get it right now. Even that is more complicated now. And then you have, of course, the restrictions that only a fifth or a third of the people are allowed in buildings. So that's the one thing. If you want to report from the actual government buildings, it's difficult. You can still do the stories. You can still travel. I traveled a lot during the last year, as my colleagues too. And that is possible, of course, if you behave and if you are careful and wear your mask and keep the distance. And I think that's what we all probably have to do more in the coming months, and we can do more.
Maybe I follow up with Juliana also, since you mentioned that we had an election year, and normally you would all travel a lot inside the US. This was possible, which might be surprising for some of the people watching this panel. Journalists have belong to a certain class in Corona regulations. Maybe one of you would like to explain that.
Mm-hmm. We are essential workers.
Exactly, essential workers,
which allows us to travel. Which also, we don't have to go into quarantine if we come back from, let's say, California or Tulsa, Oklahoma. We don't have to do it as normal people would do. That makes it easier, because if you have to go into a two-week quarantine, you probably don't do the trip for 2 days. Also, when you remember the Black Lives Matter protests we had in the last year, when people were not allowed to go on the street, there was a curfew at night. Journalists are allowed to go outside. If it's dangerous, yes, you have to be careful, but it's at least we are allowed.
And all of us who covered the Trump campaign in 2020 were also very careful after attending a Trump rally. I remember myself having several tests afterwards to be sure that I'm not a danger for my colleagues after having been close to the Trump clouds. Now, in the second part, we would like to ask all of you to describe the degree of change in domestic politics and in the atmosphere, of course. David had already a little bit touched on that. What has changed? Where can Joe Biden deliver on his ambitious agenda, and where rather not? Is Biden able to heal the divide and unite the country, as so many people are longing for? What are the odds of President Trump's second impeachment? And not everyone and each of one of you to respond to all these questions. Just pick one or two or three parts which you would like, and we go now in a different order. Let's start with Annette. What has changed in domestic politics, and what do you expect to happen?
The first thing that pops into my mind, because David already described so much how the daily politics, the policy is getting more predictable, in the meaning of the White House is communicating much better, and all the departments, for example, the State Department, they started to do a daily press briefing, which was not the case under the Trump administration. So this is already a change. But one thing that pops into my head, because everyone is super optimistic right now that Joe Biden is going to be able to heal the nation. And I think in a sense, this is true, but just to a certain extent. I'm personally very shocked that those conspiracy theories we experienced for years, for example, the Pizzagate is still alive. We had protests like a few hundred yards from my place. That Pizzagate, the conspiracy theory from 2016, is still alive in the people's minds, right?
Please explain, Annette. Not everybody might know.
It's a very strange conspiracy theory about a sex trafficking child underground thing.
That Hillary Clinton was running a pornography and child molesting circle from a pizzeria in New York, and someday somebody showed up there with a gun because he believed that these rumors are true.
Absolutely true. And I just wanted to pick that example to show that those conspiracy theories, they go a long way. And only if we have a new president now and a new administration, but this won't, you know, the anger will stay. And it just doesn't go away. I just wanted to make that clear at the very beginning. And I think the most damaging and permanent conspiracy theory, like the stolen election, this is, from my point of view, the most dangerous conspiracy theory we had in decades. And I think we have to see the Biden administration under this weight of those fake news conspiracy theories, this anger, this resentment. We always have to be very careful to be too optimistic that he's going to be able to make this all go away.
Rieke, tell us about your observations and experience.
I would agree with a lot of what Annette just said, and maybe I just pick another error so we don't have the same opinion all over again. So how does Biden now has the chance because he has the White House and the Democrats have the majority in the Senate and in the House of Representatives. So there is a 2-year window before the next midterm elections to do stuff. But then again, I think it's not going to be as easy as a lot of people would hope, because he has he has to serve two sides. He said he wants to be a president for all Americans, so he wants to try to reach out to the Republicans, but then we need to watch what the Republican Party will do, because they are still unsure how to proceed after this presidency Trump, because they don't know the Trumpism isn't going to vanish. I mean, 74 million people voted for Trump, so they will not going to have a change of heart in the next 2 minutes and say, okay, now we just align with the GOP again and with more traditional conservative values. So the GOP has to find its path, and Joe Biden has to deal with that if he wants to get majorities in the Senate. And the Senate majority, I mean, it's tight, so he needs some Republican votes. And then also there's the Democratic Party, and there's the progressive side of the Democratic Party who has been standing behind Biden in this campaign to get him elected. But now, of course, they want him to do something with the majority the Democratic Party has right now. So I think he needs to balance both sides. And we're going to see if he pushes for a more progressive agenda, which alienate the conservative voters, or if he wants to really work together with the GOP, and that might infuriate the progressive side of the Democratic Party. So I think it's really, he's not in a very easy spot, although it might seem to be that way because he has all the majorities.
Very fluid situation. And before we go to Juliana, I just throw in a few questions from the audience. Do the speakers have the feeling that the Republican Party is seriously interested in cooperative politics? How did you experience, if any one of you, the storm on the Capitol, and how would you judge the consequences on a society? How about regulations media to restore a truth baseline? And some would like to learn more about the different categories of the US media. I'm not quite sure to which degree we have the time to do that. And the question also, Donald Trump has still influence on the GOP. It seems that there are still too many GOP members addicted to Donald Trump. how do you think Joe Biden will be able to follow through with his agenda? Juliane, your thoughts, and then if nobody else touches impeachment, I would like David to answer that. But first, Juliane.
My thoughts on what's going to happen.
What has been said? It's a fluid situation. On paper, you have a majority. Do you really have it in real politics? Is 50 plus in the Senate enough? And so on and so on. But your thoughts?
I mean, coming from a country that apparently loves great coalitions, I really like the thought that Biden tries to get the support of some part of the Republican Party, because the Republican Party is a big party with very different groups in it. I don't think it's yet decided in which direction it's going to go. It doesn't look very good right now. I mean, you have the meeting tomorrow from the House Republicans to talk about the future of the extreme parts of the party, or about the different wings. I think we have to see how his optimistic speech, how his optimistic approach, if it convinces some of the Republicans to buy into that. I mean, we had the 10 senators that were in the White House yesterday, the first political group he hosted. It was a long conversation, almost 2 hours, I think. It's Biden, he likes to talk, apparently, you know. So there is some movement. And if he loses perhaps one Democrat, one moderate Democrat who will probably not vote with all his policies, he can perhaps try to get a couple of Republicans with him in legislation. So I think there's hope. I know it can be too optimistic and it can be all very bad, but it's just the beginning. Where are we? 3 weeks since he came into office. So I think that's good. January 6th, just very quickly, was, I think, terrifying. It was, even though we knew what could happen, still something that I could not imagine would really happen. I did not imagine that a fans of a president would really storm the symbol of democracy. So I think that's still a process of what really happened there on this day, who was involved, who knew about it, how planned was it. And that's why I think impeachment is a very important process moving forward.
David, before you answer or describe the general domestic situation, let me ask two questions. One is, what are the odds with impeachment? Can that be successful or rather not? And the second, more general question, can Donald Trump end up in jail? That's not only a political question, it's a question of trials which might happen in New York, especially for his business dealings, but also in Washington, D.C., when it comes to the dealings with the inauguration 2016 and doing business with himself and sending money through the inauguration party to his hotel on Pennsylvania Avenue. So what is your view, what risks are over the head of Donald Trump, David?
Well, impeachment is the first risk, and I don't think that there are great odds that he will be convicted. So right now there are 100 senators, 67 senators, two-thirds would need to vote to convict Trump. That would mean 18 Republicans would have to say yes, about that much. That's unlikely. I don't think it's impossible, just because the Republican Party has been sort of fractured by what happened on January 6th. And there are a lot of Republicans who, if they could do it in a secret ballot, would be glad to have Donald Trump off the political stage. That would be the consequence of impeaching him, is that he couldn't run again in 2024. I think there would be a lot of Republicans in the Senate who would love to see that happen, but they don't want to be the ones who make it happen. So I still think that the odds are 5% that Trump actually gets convicted. For the Democrats, I think there's a desire to, as Juliana said, to sort of put the evidence out and show people, look, this is what Donald Trump and the Republicans did. This is how they caused the storming of the Capitol, just so people don't forget. And it lays on the Republicans for years to come. I think Biden has a different set of incentives. I think Biden would be happy to just have this be over with and have Donald Trump be just completely off the stage so that he can sort of, I think Biden's goal in all of this is to get people to just stop thinking about politics that much, to have with vaccines and the reopening of the economy, to have politics just sort of recede as a part of our daily life. I think the more that happens, the happier Joe Biden will be and the better his chances for re-election. You can't really do that if Donald Trump is still in center stage.
And the jail question.
Yes.
You know so much about his business dealings and Deutsche Bank and the prosecutions in New York for his tax records and so on and so on.
Trump faces a number of, put aside his business problems, just a lot of business problems he's facing now. He also faces a number of legal challenges. There's a couple of investigations in New York. There could be one in Georgia for his attempt to influence the election there. I put the chances of him actually going to jail fairly low. I think even less than him being convicted in the Senate of impeachment, just because the one criminal investigation we know of is in New York State. It mostly deals with the finances of his company several years ago. The bar for that to be a jailable offense is pretty high. So there could be criminal charges and he could be convicted in that case, but I don't see any likely scenario where Donald Trump ends up in jail in the next couple of years.
Thank you. Also, with regard to the time, I would like to switch to our third major subject, which is U.S. foreign policy, cooperation with Europe, and generally foreign affairs. There are many fields again. We can talk about protectionism, climate change, arms control with regard to Russia, China, Iran, North Korea, U.S. troops in Germany, and more generally, how will China's strategy look like in comparison to Trump's China strategy or the Russia policy? And all that with regard, what are the consequences for Europe? What might Europe expect? What might Germany expect? Not, again, everyone has to cover every aspect. It would be nice if every one of you picks two or three subjects which the other ones did not pick. Maybe we start with Annette and the economy question. Protectionism, China strategy.
Yeah, I just try to sort it in my head. I think the most important or most exciting question we face right now, it has just indirectly something to do with economy, but is the question of the vaccine competition. Like, I think for me, the big question is whether the US and the European Union, or maybe even the UK, they will be kind of able to do a transatlantic vaccine deal or something. Because right now, everyone is doing, you know, stuff on their own and they order all the doses, but there's a competition. And that would be a great signal to the world if the US and Europe can work together on that. In regard to China, I think it's very interesting what's going on right now on the climate issue, because Washington is already sending signals to China that they might be able to do a cooperation on climate change, which is very interesting. And right now they try the carrot and sticks approach, like sending pressure signals, but at the same time showing that they are open to negotiate. And I think Biden will obviously keep the economic pressure on China, because the US are very scared that they're getting behind in the field of AI and other economic, very important technology fields of the future. So they will keep up the pressure, but at the same time, they have to prove to the world that that the new administration, they have to prove to the world that they are able to find a different approach, maybe with some results in the end, because the Trump approach didn't show any results in the end. We have to make that clear.
Thanks, Annette. When we move now to Juliane and then to Rieke, readers or viewers are also asking what can they expect from Europe? What can Europe help in order to heal, not so much the US national field, but in general terms in world politics? How are the odds that there will be a NATO-like Pacific cooperation rather than a revived transatlantic alliance? What can Europe do? Juliane.
I wanted to talk first about what I think is super interesting right now, the change in talking about climate change and how to tackle it, how to deal with it. And I think if the US government can make a change in talking about it as a chance in investing in new clean technologies in areas like Pennsylvania or Ohio, where you can bring jobs to the people, you can do infrastructure things combined with climate change inputs. I think that's super interesting, and that's something that turns it into a positive discussion and not a negative discussion, as the Trump administration tried and parts of the Republican Party were doing it for such a long time. It's not against economy. It can be something to push the economy. I think Europe has to be, and Germany perhaps especially, we have to be honest to in what we can do ourselves and what our challenges are, what our responsibilities are. And that probably starts with investing in our ability to defend ourselves better than we have done it in the past, to think about Nord Stream 2 again, try to help Biden's efforts of forming a better transatlantic alliance again, because I think that's something we profit from the most.
Rieke, next to you, opportunities but also challenges. We have had so far a rather optimistic tone, but there can also be disappointments that every side expects too much from the other to do the work to come together. America is hoping that Europe is changing its course, Germany or Nord Stream, other things, and probably Europe is hoping that Biden will change, do the most by changing the course of the alliance. So, Rieke, where do you see the opportunities, but also the challenges and possible disappointments?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the opportunity is that there will be a change of tone from the White House, that Joe Biden has always stressed that he believes in the idea of alliances, so that he wants to be a partner, not being the bully in the room saying, so this is who we are and this is what we want to do. So I think there lies a lot of opportunity. I agree with Juliane, from a European and transatlantic standpoint, Germany, we have to figure out what we can do to strengthen this transatlantic partnership. I think there's also a chance, because with the Brexit, with Great Britain leaving the European Union, I think the Biden administration will focus more on the continent than on Great Britain. So there's also an opportunity. I think the overall challenge, not only for Europe, but for for the world in general, is that how reliable is the United States going to be as a partner going forward? I mean, we have high hopes in the Biden administration, but we have seen a lot of shifts and turn over the last couple of years in administrations. And I think, I mean, now we see Biden going back to the Paris Climate Agreement, wanted to join WHO. But what happens when he's not going to be reelected 4 years from now? What will happen then? I think so long-term alliances is something that everybody in the world has to be very cautious about. And that is a big challenge for this American administration. How much trust do you put in things Biden puts forward now?
David, I would like to challenge you also with a question. Where do you expect Joe Biden to deliver, and where we should rather expect lip service with little follow-up in practice? I mean, in Germany and in Europe, there are so many expectations. Now we have China and the Uyghurs and Russia and Burma, Myanmar for the time being, and they are talking about a more moral foreign policy of the United States. Is that a realistic expectation when it comes to climate change? Of course, we have seen the presidential first steps in that direction, joining again the Paris Climate Accord. But on the other hand, when we look to the Senate, and there we have Democratic senators like Manchin from West Virginia, or the new senator, female senator from Arizona, who are probably not giving 100% their vote behind two stark reforms. So where could you give us your assessment, but also a little warning? Don't be too over-optimistic, our dear Germans and Europeans, what you expect from Joe Biden.
Well, I think the other panelists are right that what Biden has done so far is the easy stuff. He's just going back to what Trump, restoring what Trump had torn down. My question is, like, so many of the folks that Biden has brought in are folks who were in the Obama administration. And what did we learn about the Obama administration foreign policy? Was that they had trouble knowing what to do when people pushed back on them. Think about drawing a red line in Syria and then not following through. Think about the way that the Russians took Crimea and did other actions, and Obama sort of talked big but didn't do anything. China's another example. You know, that group of people seemed unable, during the Obama time, to know what to do with U.S. power. What was the right amount of U.S. power to use to stop somebody short of war? Trump then threw all that out and decided he would sort of go back to the madman theory, where he seemed crazy enough to do anything, and that might scare people into not pushing the U.S. Now that Biden has gone back to a tone of cooperation, normalcy in the U.S., how is he going to solve the problem that Obama could not, which is to deter people who are not afraid of U.S. soft power and without using U.S. hard power?
So in the last round, I will all of you like to ask, and pick carefully what you would like to say, because each of you will have less than 2 minutes, rather between 1 and 1.5 minutes. What is your benchmark when you try to think ahead 4 years from now? When I look back at President Joe Biden's 4 years in his first term, what is your benchmark where you would make your judgment whether he was a successful president or not a successful president? Is it reconciliation? Is it Corona? Is it bringing the world, the US, back into the global multilateral order? Whatever is your pick, and just be sharp and precise what you think you would tell us, what benchmark you would suggest. David, let's start with you.
I think success for Joe Biden would look a lot like Ronald Reagan's first term. You would have a lot of economic success as the vaccines come in, as the stimulus money gets the economy going again. And people would look at the president at the end of 4 years like they did at Reagan, which is he's a little old and maybe seems a little strange. And, but I don't think about him all the time. When I do think about him, I think positively because my life's gotten better. But, there's not a cult around him. There's not a, I'm not spending all my time arguing about politics. And that's great. That's a sign of success for Joe Biden. So after 4 years, if the economy's going, politics recedes from American life, and Biden seems like kind of a funny but successful guy that you don't want to change, I think that would be success for him.
Rieke, what is your assessment? We right now the year 2024, you look back at 4 years under Joe Biden, and what do you think will be your judgment, or what will be the benchmark for your judgment?
I think success, to add on what David said, would mean that we don't say after every sentence or everything that comes out of the White House, this is fact or this is fiction, that we can like rely a little bit more on the truth that is out there and that is reliable. That would be success. Also, I think success would be that there would be even a little bit more social and racial justice for American people. I think that is something that is very important for the American people. COVID shows that how racial inequality and social inequality determine life chances here. So that would be a success as well if that would be improving.
So Annette.
Yeah, for me, the benchmark would be something we can count on in the long run. Will there be a trade deal with the EU? Will there be a trade deal with China? Will there be a real shift in renewable energies in the US? Not just some executive orders, but maybe a real green infrastructure reform in Congress, something we will talk about it in 10 years from now. If Biden achieves something like this, even if it's just one piece of it, then it will be a great administration.
And last but not least, Juliana.
Everything that is said, of course, is super important. I will just end and say, if he can make it possible to leave from power in 4 years and pave the way for the first woman in the White House as president, that could be also a good way to move forward.
And you are thinking about the vice president.
I don't know. We'll see in 4 years. That's much too early. I don't want to talk about the next election.
So since you have all responded so sharply and shortly, let's expand on that last thought. If it will be maybe a match between two women on the Democratic side, it's easier to make a suggestion because there is Kamala Harris as vice president. But is there also women in politics on the Republican side?
I think it's even easier to bet on the Republican side, to be honest. I know that Kamala Harris is in a great spot right now, but I think the next candidate from the Republicans will definitely be a woman.
And who will that be?
It's hard to predict names right now. I just know that, from Nikki Haley and like 5 or 6 names on, but they can't afford not to do it.
But thanks. The name is great because just imagine from the German perspective and our discussions here about anti-racism and so on, if there would be a match like Kamala Harris, the daughter of immigrants from India and Jamaica, and Nikki Haley, who is a descendant from Indian immigrants, that tells us a lot about the colors of the United States, the American society. So I thank you very much for a wonderful panel. I shortly switch from my role as moderator to also answer my last question. Since the title of our panel was Another Normal, Prospects for US Democracy, Politics and the Media, I think it would be a great achievement if Joe Biden could just bring back normalcy to the United States. This feeling that we don't, as you all have said, don't get up in the morning and wonder what the president has twittered overnight, where the next conflicts are, whether they are domestic or in international politics, just normalcy. And then even I could forgive him if he can't pass any great reforms. That would be great. I thank you all very much, and I hope you all at home see reason to applaud our panelists from the other side of the Atlantic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stay healthy.
Yeah. Thank you so much, you four in Washington. You were great. It was very lively. It was entertaining. It was fun. Thank you so much. And many thanks to the lucid moderation of Dr. Christoph Freiherr von Marschall zu Bieberstein. Thank you very much, you five.